Hello, Pia. My name is Lisa Wairimo from Lockwood Girls High School, Form 3. Welcome to Science Hub. My colleagues are
Sharon Malisi,
Shireen Taylor.
Today we'll be discussing phylum Chordata and our classification too.
In phylum Chordata, some of its characteristics are that they have a notochord on the dorsal side at some stage of their development. Also, they have bodies with a bilateral symmetry. And also they have a single dorsal tubular nerve cord and an endoskeleton.
Some other characteristics of the phylum Chordata are they have visceral clefts, which means they have slits perforating the body walls at the pharynx. Others are they have a closed circulatory system, which means the blood flows through veins. They also have segmented muscle blocks, known as mitons, on either side of their body. They also possess an internal skeleton.
In phylum Chordata, it is divided into 5 classes, whereby I'm going to list and explain some of them. The first class is class Reptilia. We have class Amphibia. Number 3, we have class Pisces. Number 4, we have class Aves. And finally, we have class Mammalia. I'm going to start with class Reptilia. In class Reptilia, we have examples of animals like the snake, the tortoise, the lizard. Yeah, and the general characteristics is that they are ectothermic, meaning that their body temperature changes depending on the environmental conditions. They can also be called poikilotherms. The other characteristic is that their body is covered with a dry, scaly skin to reduce desiccation. The third characteristic is that their fertilization is internal and that they use 4 limbs to walk and some crawl like the snake. On to class Amphibia. We have an example here of class Amphibia, whereby we have the frog in this chair. Some characteristics of class Amphibia is that they have 4 well-developed limbs, whereby we have the forelimbs and the hind limbs. These are the limbs which are on the front are the forelimbs, and then these ones which are at the back, they are the hind limbs. The other characteristics is that the gaseous exchange is through the skin, the gills, or the buccal cavity, which can also be called the mouth. The other characteristic is that they are also ectothermic, meaning that their body temperature changes with the environmental conditions. The other characteristics is that they have 2 eardrums behind the ears. Yeah. And then the other characteristic is that fertilization is external while they breed in water. You can also say that they live a double life. So we go to class Pisces. Class Pisces, these are the animals which live in water. Mostly here we're going to talk about the fish. I have an example here. This is an example of a fish, and it lives in water. As we can see it, this is a fish. Yeah, it's an example of class Pisces. Some of the general characteristics of class Pisces is that they possess a lateral line, which is used as, there's a lateral line, which is used as a sensory organ. They use it to sense danger. And then their eyes consist of a nictitating membrane, so that when they move in water, the water cannot pass through their eyes. The other thing is that their respiratory surface is that they use the gills, which are covered by the operculum over here. Their fertilization is externally. Yeah, they fertilize their eggs externally, whereby the fish pours out its ovum, then the male fish comes pouring out its sperm, and that's where they breed eggs. They breed a lot of eggs so that to increase the chances of survival. And that's all for the three classes. My colleague will pick it up from there.
The next class is class apes. Class apes comprises of birds. Birds, common birds include chicken, goose, and hawks. Some characteristics of class apes are: their body are covered with feathers for insulation and flight. Second characteristic is their bones are hollow. Their bones are hollow so that they can fly. The third characteristic is they have beaks. These beaks are used to pick grains or pick insects. The fifth characteristic is they have hind limbs, which are used for walking or swimming. They also have forelimbs, which are used for flying. The next characteristic is the hind limbs have scaly skin. The other characteristic is they have a double circulation with a four-chambered heart. This means that the blood goes through the heart twice. The other characteristic is they are endothermic. The next class is class Mammalia. Class Mammalia consists of mammals. Mammals such as man, whales, etc. Some of the characteristics are they have mammary glands, hence the name Mammalia. Their body is usually covered with fur or hair. Their teeth have been differentiated into four, namely incisors, canines, premolars, and molars. They have two pinnae. Pinnae means ears. They usually have sweat glands. The next characteristic is they have lungs for gaseous exchange. They also have a double circulatory system with a four-chambered heart. They have four limbs, the hands and the legs. They are also endothermic.
We now go to the Cotoner's key. The Cotoner's key is a biological identification key. Some of the rules in the dichotomous key are such as: the first one is use morphological characteristics as much as possible. This means that you should use some of the characteristics that are visible. The second characteristic is that state with major characteristics that divide the organism into two large groups, then proceed to the minor variations. The third one is select a single characteristic at a time and identify it using a number. The fourth one is use similar forms of wording for the two constructing statements. The fifth one is the first statement should always be written in the positive form. And the sixth one is avoid generalization of overlapping variation. Be specific.
Some common features used for identifications. We'll start with animals. In animals, you can use locomotory structures such as fins, legs. You can use the antennae presence and number. You can also use the number of body parts. Like in insects, you have three body parts, and in some, you have two body parts. You can use the body segmentation. You can also use the structures on the body, if it's fur, hair, or just skin. We can use the feeding structures, example, beaks. We can use the type of skeleton present, either exoskeleton or endoskeleton. In plants, we can use the leaf. In the leaf, we can state the color of the leaf. We can state the lamina. We can state the leaf venation. We can state the leaf type. For the flower, we can use the inflorescence type. We can use the flower shape, and we can use the number of floral parts. In the stem, we can use the type of stem, either woody or fleshy. We can use the shape, either rectangular, circular. We can use the texture of stem, whether smooth or rough. In the roots, we can use the root system. Now there are two types of roots, that is the taproot and the fibrous root. And we can also use the storage root. Now in the leaf,
there is the structure of the leaf. Now here at the top, we have the apex. Here at the middle, we have the midrib. Here at the bottom, we have the petiole. This space between the veins, we have the lamina. These are the veins. And this is the margin. Now this is the structure of a simple leaf.
Now when we come to classifying leaves in the dichotomous scheme, we can use the arrangement of leaves. Mostly we are supposed to use the common feature that will distinguish all features. Example, we can use the compound leaf and the simple leaf. Then the rest we can... We have come to the end of our discussion today on Science Hub. I've been Lisa Werimu.
Shireen Taylor.
Keep it Elimu TV.
Watch and learn.